I'm going to show you 9 things to try. If you're having any issues with the L, R, ZL, or ZR buttons on your Nintendo Switch Pro controller, issues such as these, which includes buttons activating on their own, or buttons not responding when you press them. The first solutions I show you are things you can do from the outside of your controller, but as I progress through the list, I'm going to take you deeper and deeper inside. Start with solution 1 and proceed onward until your button is fixed or until you reach the end of your comfort level. One of the common reasons these buttons can have issues is because debris gets in around the gaps, which interferes with the mechanics. So the first thing to try is to get a small piece of cardboard from a consumer product or something, and basically make a blade out of it. Then move it around inside the gaps around whatever button is giving you the issue. The overall idea is to scrape off any gunk that is stuck inside around the plastic. If you really want to get crazy, you can wet the cardboard. Just make sure there's no coloring on it, or else the dye might come off and stain your controller. And you don't want it to be too soggy, or else the cardboard might rip off and get inside the buttons. And if it does that, it might make the problems worse. If it does get inside, just keep watching the video, because we're going to be going inside the controller anyway. Now, as an alternative to cardboard, you can also use a toothbrush and pretty much do the same thing with that, but I do find the cardboard works a little bit better. So if the cardboard didn't work, go grab your vacuum cleaner if it has a detachable hose like this, and then just suck around the problematic button. Make sure you're pressing the button up and down as you do this. You'll need to cup your hand a little bit to get the suction just right. This is a good follow-up to the cardboard because you may have scraped something off and the debris is still down inside, so hopefully this will suck it out. The third solution is to blow around the buttons. A good way to do this is with a straw. Just bend the end a little bit and push it down into the gap. You can also use canned air. If you have an electric duster, such as this one, you can use that, of course. You can also use a hairdryer. Just make sure it's on the cool setting. You don't want to blow heat down in there. If you're finding this video helpful, feel free to hit that like button. Let's continue. So if none of those initial cleaning methods worked, there's some electronic things we can try before we go inside the controller. The first thing is to make sure that you have the latest firmware update on your controller. Before that, make sure you have the latest system update on your Switch, because the controller updates are built into those system updates. Then go to System Settings. Then go to Controllers and Sensors. Then out to the right, select Update Controllers. It'll either run an update, or it'll say it's already up to date. There's one last thing you can try that does not involve going inside your controller, so you might want to seriously consider this. Whatever button you are having a problem with, you can remap it to another button, one that works. Here's how to do it. Go to System Settings, Controllers and Sensors, and Change Button Mapping. On the left, highlight the controller you wish to configure, and then select Change on the right side. Select the button you want to change to another button and press A, and then select whatever button you want that button to change to and press A. Do the same for any other buttons you wish to change. The button remaps you do on this screen will show in blue. Select Done and they will go into effect. Every time someone powers the system on, a message will appear saying that the buttons have been remapped, and it provides a button on the screen to reset them to default. If the user selects that, the buttons will remain at default, even if the system gets powered off again. So the rest of the solutions I show you are going to involve going inside the controller. Just a warning that anytime you're going inside an electronic device, something bad can happen. You can make the problem worse. You can break the controller. I'm going to do everything I can to describe everything as carefully as possible, but you know, you could drop a screwdriver on the main board, so there is risk involved in doing this. I will say that this controller is a little bit easier to work inside than other ones, like the DualShock 4. I also want to point out that as they manufacture these controllers, they do little changes to the inside of them. So don't be surprised if you open up your controller and it looks slightly different on the inside. But hopefully the details I give you will work on all the different variations out there. So solution 6 involves opening up the controller a little bit to get up closer to the ZR and ZL buttons so that you can give them a better cleaning and to inspect them to see if there's any damage. If you're here because your L or R button isn't working, you still need to do this part because I need to show you how to take apart the controller. Your first step is to remove these two screws from the handles. All these screws today will be Phillips screws. I'm going to be using a size 000, but some of the other sizes that are close to that will also work. I get asked all the time what happens if you encounter a screw that won't turn. A good solution is to put a couple of drops of water on it and to let it soak. Don't worry, a couple of drops is not going to ruin your controller. Wipe the water away and remove any gunk that's around the screw and also tap on it. Hopefully that helps. One more thing I'll say is to be organized with your screws as we go into the controller today. There's different sizes and different colors. So with the screws out of the handles will slip right off. Now we're going to remove these four screws. The whole backing will now come off if you just give it a little lift. I'm going to go ahead and take the battery out at this point as well, because I intend on going deeper into the controller. But at this point, if your problem is the ZL or ZR buttons, you now have more access to them. You can use some of the cleaning methods I showed earlier to better clean them. This is a good place to use a toothbrush. It's also a good idea to blow into there. Now you'll notice there's these two rubber pads underneath the buttons. When you press down on the button, it should press down on the pad, which in turn touches a contact on a flex cable. Do not remove the rubber, but raise it up a little bit and you can clean underneath it with a Q-tip or something. Now you also want to take this time to inspect to see if you notice any damage to any of these components. It's possible you might have dropped the controller, or you may have been using the controller so much, plastic may have bent or something. There may even be pieces of plastic stuck in there from a button that is falling apart. If you do notice something that needs replaced, you'll have to wait until I show you how to get deeper into the controller. This solution involves going in even deeper so that we can get closer to the four buttons that we're working on today. Remove these five screws. Some of the screws in this step are recessed, so you'll have to use a screwdriver with a long neck. Now we're going to separate the two halves of the controller. Now don't just yank it apart, because there's going to be a ribbon cable that connects the two halves. And there you see it. This ribbon cable is held on by two different connectors. We're going to disconnect the one that's on the half that doesn't have the analog sticks on it. Now, this is where you might start noticing a lot of things that are different with your controller compared to mine. My ribbon cable is held in by a black gate. And what I'm going to do is raise up that black gate. It just kind of flung out of there. Now we have a lot more access to the buttons, including the L and R buttons. Press on both of them and compare them and see if one of them is responding differently. Once again, clean out any debris that you see. Blow air in there, use a toothbrush, do whatever you can. Also inspect to see if you see any damage to any of the components. In a moment, I'll show you how to actually replace the buttons, should you have to do that. So this solution involves taking apart this controller a little bit more, which will allow us to replace any components that need replaced. There are a lot of replacement buttons and components for sale on Amazon, and I'll put affiliate links to those in the description should you need those parts. We are going to disconnect this ribbon cable here. Mine has a black gate that's on the opposite side of the ribbon, and I'm going to just flick that up with my fingernail, and then I'll pull the ribbon out. I'm also going to remove these two screws here. These will be the final two screws we have to remove today. So now I can just grab the button assembly and just pull it away from the plastic. You'll find people selling this whole assembly. So if you have a lot of major problems with your trigger buttons and you don't want to repair them yourself, just swap this out for another one. You now have a lot of access to the L and R buttons. So all the things about cleaning and getting under that pad will work here as well. Even if you're not having an issue with every single one of these buttons, it's a great opportunity to clean out anything you see in there on either side. You can also lift up the L and R buttons by just pulling outward a little bit and then just pulling it up. This gives you access to the rubber pad, which you can remove and inspect it and clean it. You can also get a Q-tip with some alcohol and clean the contact that was underneath it. If your L and R buttons are damaged, you can actually remove them pretty easily by just pulling them straight out of the hinge. Removing the ZR and ZL buttons is not quite as easy. There is a metal rod that goes through them and keeps them in there, and the only way to remove the button is to remove the rod. For some people, that rod does not move easily. For me, all I have to do is take some tweezers and just pull it out. Now be very careful, there is a ribbon cable that goes underneath that rod. So as you're poking around that area, make sure you're not damaging that ribbon cable. If it doesn't feel like it's moving, try doing this. Get a very small flathead screwdriver and go underneath to this gap here. And if you do it just right, you can push on the other end of that rod to at least get it going. Now the buttons will come out and you can replace those buttons if you want. And you have access to the rubber pads and the contacts. The last solution is to replace the flex cable that runs through the assembly. I only recommend this solution if you're desperate. This flex cable is very fragile. It feels like it's stuck on there with adhesive, so it might be easy to tear. But of course, if you're replacing it with another one, it may not make a difference if you tear it or not. I'm not actually going to do this to my own controller because the risk is too high. But like I said, if you're desperate, peel that thing off and put a new one in. I'm not sure if the new one will have any adhesive on it, but it does have to be on there pretty tightly, it looks like, in order to work. So now I'm going to show you how to put everything back together. The rubber pads for ZL and ZR will go right back in. You just have to push the little rubber rods through the holes. The longer rod goes toward the middle of the controller. You'll want to pull on one side and push on the other at the same time. And then put the ZR and ZL buttons back in and slide the rod into them. The rubber pads for the L and R buttons go on pretty easily. One of the holes is bigger than the other, so that'll tell you how to position it. You can then snap the L and R buttons back into the hinge, pull them slightly outward as you push them back into position. Set the whole assembly back into place, and put those two screws back in. Put that ribbon cable back in. The cable has to be lined up perfectly, and it's gonna need a little bit of pushing. There's a little bit of a nub on the far side of the cable that allows you to push it straight in. On mine, I had a black gate that I need to have in the open position, and then once the ribbon is in place, I close it with my fingernail. Now we need to reconnect this larger ribbon cable. On mine, I had to open the black gate and then push it in straight and then slam the gate down. Connect the two halves. Put these screws back in. Put the battery back in. The connectors on the battery should align with the three connectors on the side right here. Then place the back cover back on. And then put these four screws back in. slip the handles back on. They only go on one way, but you'll know when you get it just right. And then screw in the two screws on the handles. Well, that's it, folks. If one of these solutions helped you fix your controller, let me know which one it was in the comments below. Have a great day, everybody.